couple of things. Are you on me?
Yes.
Good morning. Welcome to worship. A little better start than last week. Good morning, Jimmy. It's very funny to me. A couple of prayer requests. Lenny asked for prayers for her friend Jeff, who is struggling with some health issues. And Chris Borsum, owner of Christopher Mark Fine Flowers and Gifts in Brookfield, was recently diagnosed with cancer. So if we could keep him in our prayers. Yeah, I think that's all we have for prayer requests. Worship should be smoother than last week. So we've got music back. Everybody's here. Let's take a moment and prepare ourselves for worship. Alex.
Everybody hurts.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Everlasting God, you give strength to the weak and power to the faint. Make us agents of your healing and wholeness, that your good news may be made known to the ends of your creation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes from the prophet Isaiah, the 40th chapter. We'll start with verse 21, so I'll give you a second to find Isaiah 40, verse 21. The first lesson comes from Isaiah chapter 40. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers who stretch out the heavens like a curtain. He spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown. Scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? And who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their lost and numbers them, calling them all by name. Because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading today comes from 1 Corinthians, so New Testament. Partway through, we're going to look at chapter 9. So that's 1 Corinthians. Remember, there are two Corinthians, so you want the first one? Chapter 9, we'll be starting with verse 16. Paul writes, if I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Join us in singing our gospel acclamation.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
Our gospel reading today comes from the Gospel of Mark, second book of the New Testament. We're still in the first chapter of Mark. We'll be starting with verse 29. The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons. And the whole city was gathered around the door, and he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring town so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Would you pray with me? Gracious God, we give you thanks for this day, for a return to seeing and participating in worship from the building, at least, if not in the building. We give you thanks for all that you give us and ask that you send your Holy Spirit among us now. Open our hearts and our minds. Bless the words of my mouth, that they carry to your people an understanding and a joy of your strength and your message and all that you give. In your holy name we pray. Amen. So the Isaiah text is kind of an interesting one. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? Isaiah is talking to the people and pointing out that they're missing the point. You've heard me say this before. This happens on kind of a cycle throughout the Bible, especially in the Old Testament, where people are following God, and then they kind of fall away from God, and they start doing their own thing, and then a prophet comes and says, "Hello, you messed it up." Well, the people of Israel are in that place where they've messed it up, where they've missed it. And we get a hint at what they're looking at, because, where'd it go? He quotes them and says, what does he say? He quotes them, the people of Israel, as saying, "My way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God." So apparently the people are complaining that God's not paying attention to them, that things aren't going their way, the way they think they should go. Now, I know none of you have ever experienced that. I know I haven't. That's not true. Hopefully lightning doesn't come down. Of course, we all get to that point where we get in, things are happening and things aren't happening the way we want them to or the way we think they should. And we were like, why is God not helping me? I mean, how many of us have said that over the past year, just in this, as we start getting really close to the beginning, to the anniversary, the 1 year anniversary of the beginning of the stay-at-home pandemic? I mean, the pandemic itself is older, but having to stay at home, that's not the way things were supposed to go. I know I did not plan to stay at home for a year. I had plans. Robert and I were going to open a theater. It hasn't happened because we can't have a live theater in person. We had all kinds of plans, but things didn't go our way. And so we get the people of Israel saying, "My way is hidden from the Lord and my right is disregarded by my God." I mean, we would probably say it differently. Those who want to question the existence of God put this question to us all the time. Where is your God in the midst of this? One of the big ones that happened, I remember, was after 9/11. And the people who tried to say God doesn't exist, that was their big question. Where is your God in the midst of this terrible disaster? And people say it now, where is your God in the midst of this pandemic? And the answer comes back to Isaiah saying, have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth. And Isaiah goes on to talk about all this power that God has, even over princes. They're barely planted and grown, he says. When God is like, okay, you're done, and their life is over. Have you not heard? Have you not seen? The question that Isaiah puts to us, God working in the world. And then he makes a promise, and I love this promise. I love the song that's been written about this promise. And he shall lift you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the break of dawn. We know that song, Eagle's Wings. The beauty of that song that tells us that God is working. He's there. He's going to take care of you. And we see it again in the gospel today, because we have the gospel. Now, if you remember from last week and the week before, Jesus had started calling his disciples, and now he was preaching in the synagogues. And last week they said, "Who? What is this? He teaches and heals and with authority like nobody else has ever done before." And after that all happens, we have this today's reading where they leave and they're in Galilee, and so they go to Peter's house. Well, Simon, but we haven't called him Peter yet. They go to Simon's house, and Simon's mother-in-law is sick, and they walk in and tell her about him, about her, and Jesus walks right up to her and takes her by the hand, and she's healed. The power of God working in the world. And we had seen last week even, somebody cried out and said, "We know who you are," because he was possessed by a demon. And Jesus banished the demon and wouldn't let him talk. And so people have heard this, and that whole evening they start coming. And it says they come at sunset, because before sunset it would have been working on the Sabbath. So that whole night people start bringing, and they said, Mark tells us, him all who were sick and possessed with demons. And they gathered at the door of Simon's house so that Jesus could heal them. And he spent, we don't know how long, he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. People heard about it. They heard that he had this power, and they brought people to be healed. And then an interesting thing happens, and I think this is important. We get stuck on Jesus doing the healing and Jesus doing the power and Jesus doing the preaching. And there's only a couple places where this next part happens. It says, in the morning, while it was still very dark, so early morning, morning that I don't see, because I don't get up that early. Jesus gets up, and it says he got up and he went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. He spent the whole day and night the day before teaching with authority and healing all night. People just bringing all the people who were sick and had demons. He spent all that work. He had to be exhausted. So what does he do? He goes off by himself to pray, to recharge. We're going to hear more about Jesus recharging in a few weeks. Another time that he recharges, and he does it, this time he does it after he's done all this work, after he's showed all this power of God. The next time we talk about it in depth, he does it before he's about to do something big. He charges up to go in. But this one, he takes some time to himself to be quiet, to pray. It's a reminder to us, even in the midst of all this stuff, as we see all the things going on, that we need to take time for ourselves, to be alone, whether your prayer is something specific that you write out or read from a book, whether it's lifting up people in your lives, or whether it's just meditation, time to just focus in on your life force, if nothing else. Recognize the love around you that connects you with people around you. Recognize God working in your world. Because we have the promise that Isaiah gives us. And he will lift you up on eagle's wings. It's the promise that God will take care of you. Now, it's interesting because after he prays, the disciples go out there. He's gone. They're like, what happened? And they hunt him down. That's the word that's the translation anyway, of the word that Mark uses. People are hunting for you. And he says, after they found him, Jesus says to them, okay, let's go on to the next town. He doesn't go back to the people in that town right away who he knows are looking for him because he knows they want more healing, and he could do that, but he doesn't. He goes on to the next town to spread the message again that things are not the way people have seen, to spread the message to remind them of the promise of Isaiah that God has power in this world, that God is working. But Jesus doesn't make sure he gets to every single person. That's not how it works. That's never how God has worked. He's never interrupted every single person's every day and made things the way they think they should be. Not everyone gets healed by Jesus. Not everyone in his time meets him in person. Not everyone hears him preach. He moves on to continue to tell the message. But that doesn't mean that God isn't with those people. That doesn't mean that they don't know the presence of God in the world. And that's what we have to remember when we're in these times that aren't going our way. We have to remember that God still is here. My favorite picture from, one of my favorite pictures from 9/11, it's hard to think that there are favorite pictures from 9/11. It was pretty terrible, but it was a drawing of the Twin Towers, and you could see the smoke in it, and obviously it had been attacked, and up sketched in the clouds was Jesus weeping because he was with his people. He was with us. God connects us. Even as you looked at that tragedy or other tragedies and you feel in your heart how terrible it is, you're connected through love to those people. There was a home shooting, considered a mass shooting because 6 people were killed last week. And one of them, it was a mother and I don't remember who all they were, but a couple of them were children, young children. And I heard that story and you just feel your heart go out. For all of them, but there's something about when innocent children are hurt. Why? That's that connection. That is God working in the world. That is the power of God uniting us. That is what we hear from Isaiah. Have you not heard? Have you not seen? He's been in power since the beginning of foundation. He continues since the foundations of the earth. He continues to have power and work in the world. Yeah, not on our timeline, not the way we would want to see things happen. Of course, we would have preferred if God like steered the airplanes away from the towers that day. We would prefer if the bullets, God sent angels to stand around that family when they were shot. Of course, we would prefer that. And it's not saying that God couldn't do that or doesn't want to do that. We don't know God's reasons. That's another thing Isaiah says. We have to be careful. There are things that are unsearchable, he says. His mind is unsearchable. His understanding is unsearchable. does things that are, we just don't get. Because that's just how the power of God works in the world. But what we do know is the power of God is in the world. God has promised to lift you up on eagle's wings. God has promised to take care of you, even in the worst times, even when it's not the way you think it should be. God is with us, and you can see it happening. We open our eyes, and we see it. And when we're too tired, we remember Jesus going and taking a break by himself to pray. Maybe for you it's in small groups or Sunday morning when we pray, or as a reminder, we still at Faith have Wednesday and Fridays at 7 p.m. We encourage everyone to stop and pray the Lord's Prayer. Take a moment out of whatever's going on in your life and rest and let God recharge you. And in doing that, you see God working in the world. You remember what you have been told, what you have seen, that God has been in charge since the foundations of the earth, and God continues to be there, even when it doesn't go your way. Sometimes the answer is not what we want. But God always has you. He lifts you up on eagle's wings so that you may know his presence and his power, and you may share that story with those who need to hear it. Amen. Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. For today's prayers of intercession, we will end each petition with, "Let us pray." and invite you to respond with, "Have mercy, O God." Guided by Christ, made known to the nations, let us offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For the church, for ministries of healing and wholeness, for hospital, hospice, and military chaplains, for those serving in prison ministry, and for all who proclaim freedom and release in the name of Christ, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For creation, for insects in the grass, clouds on the mountaintops, for cattle and the rainwater they drink, for the humility to take our place among all creatures of the earth, let us pray. Have mercy, O God. For the nations, for all who lead in cities and towns, states and countries, for community organizers, school officials, and CEOs, for international health organizations, that in times of trial, fear, and hopelessness, they find freedom in service to those most in need, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For all wearied by life's burdens, for those who are poor, for those lacking supportive relationships, for those crushed by debt, for those struggling with chronic pain or other sicknesses, for those exhausted from overwork or stress, and for all who cry out to you, especially all we serve through Share Food, Share Love Food Pantry, everyone on our congregation's prayer list, and those we name silently or out loud now. Let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
For this congregation, for outreach and social ministries centered here, for parish nurses and visitors, for ministries of companionship and support, for the young people in this place who open us to new understandings, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
In thanksgiving for the faithful departed, who were called by name and now rest from their labors, that their lives serve as witnesses to the goodness of God, let us pray.
Have mercy, O God.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. I invite you to share the peace with yourself and with others, and through the internet, however it works for you. Jazz hands, it's a thing. At this time, we will move on to communion. Just a couple of reminders. I will lead us through the words of institution, if I don't cover my face too much. I invite you to indicate your, or lift up, or touch your elements, your bread and your wine, such as they are during that time. Then we will join together in the Lord's Prayer, after which we will sing, and I will invite you to share the meal with whoever is present with you, as we all share it at the same time together. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you forever in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Receive the benediction. God the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus the Beloved, fill you. And the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen. Let's remember who we are as a community. A community of disciples embodying the unconditional love of Jesus with a firm commitment to the feeding of body and soul. I have a couple of announcements. The new Our Daily Bread devotional books for March, April, May are here. If you would like one, let Jill know in the office, either email or you can leave a message on the church phone and she will send them out to you. The annual meeting is 2 weeks from today. That's February 21st. We'll do it at 11, and it will be a Zoom meeting, I think is what we're still planning to do. That information will go out, how we're going to do that sometime. But the main thing is, 2 weeks from today, remember there's an annual meeting. We will elect council members and vote on the budget. And if anybody wants to be a council member, we still have potential spots. So let John Dumas or Alan Bringman or myself know if you want to do that. That is, I think, all I have. So go in peace, feed the hungry.
Thanks be to God.
Show me where to look, tell me what will I find, what will I find? Oh, heaven, let your light shine down. Oh, heaven, let your light shine down. Oh, heaven, let your light shine down. your light shine now. Love is in the water, love is in the air. Show me where to look, tell me, will love be there? Will love be there? Teach me how to speak, teach me how to share. Teach me where to go, tell me, will love be there? Will love be there? Shine down. Oh, heaven, let your light shine down.